Hi, I'm Paul McCormick. I'm the Culinary Arts Instructor here at Community College of Philadelphia, and I have a guest with me today.
I'm Ollie Johnson. I'm the Athletic Director here at the college.
And what we're going to talk about today is demystifying barbecued ribs. Now, ribs are something that I personal favorite of mine for eating, preparing, and barbecuing. I'm an expert in barbecue, but everybody who cooks barbecue is really an expert in barbecue. We're going to talk about four different things today. We're going to talk about the meat. I'm going to specifically talk about ribs. We're going to talk about the dry rub, which is a really important ingredient in the process. We're going to talk about sauce, and we're also going to talk about smoke. Now, in between my instructions, Ollie's going to drop in with all of his expertise on what we're going to do today. First, I'm going to start with the meat.
Very little.
Oh, you have a lot of expertise. Right now, I have two different ribs here, and they look similar, but there's a big difference between these two ribs. It sounds funny, but you know, I have a full set of ribs, but on a hog, there's a full set of ribs, but they sell two different types of ribs. They call something called a St. Louis rib, which actually comes from the belly part, and the back ribs, which actually come from the back. So you can get four racks of ribs off of one hog. There's a difference though. When you look at the side cut of this, the size of the rib is different. It's St. Louis rib, which comes from the belly. The bones are wider. From the ribs, or for the back section, the ribs are going to be smaller. The bone's actually going to be smaller. For preparation for what we're going to do, there's one really important thing that you have to do butchering-wise before we start making the ribs, before we start the rub or anything else. We remove this membrane on the back of the rib. Now, I have three racks of ribs that we're going to do today because I have three shelves in the smoker. I'm going to start by taking this piece right here and taking my bone and just pulling this membrane from the back of the rib. This is what makes it really tough. Some people take a knife and score this, but it still leaves this membrane on the back of the meat. Now, I'll use a rag, and it comes off just like unwrapping a package. It's going to come off in one big piece, and this piece of sinew is really, really tough. And if you leave this on the meat, it makes your ribs really tough. This comes off in one piece. From the St. Louis rib, I'll do the same thing. Like I said, these ribs are larger, or the bone is wider, but I have to do the same thing. And as you know, if you notice here closely, this membrane doesn't go all the way down. It actually stops right about here and goes from underneath this flap, and this is actually closer to the inside of the rib. So this piece is going to be significantly smaller. It doesn't go all the way down to the last two bones. On a normal back rib, there's usually 13 bones. And that's how you can tell you have a rack of baby backs. 13 ribs from one end to the other. Now, I'm going to take this one off. This is where we're going to start. So that piece comes off smaller than this piece. This is what a full rack of baby back ribs look like. The other thing I'm going to take off is this little chunk of meat and sinew here. This will tend to have to catch fire and burn when you go to flame these if you're going to put these on an open grill. Now, the next thing that I want to talk about is our rub. Because at this point, we can either smoke the ribs, put them in the smoker and start the smoking process, or rub them and grill them and then do the smoking process. The idea here is the average time it takes me to cook ribs is about 3 to 4 hours, and that's cooking baby backs. How often who cooks the ribs?
Well, the wife is great. I just prepare the smoker and do the labor and the muscle.
Well, you want to know something? I'm good for the muscle. I'm not good for the thinking because I'm not allowed to think. That's just the way our relationship works. But I am in charge of taking care of the meat and getting the meat prepared. One of the things we do when we prepare the meat is I make a dry rub. You've heard that said before about certain barbecue products. And a dry rub is a spice mixture that we use on the outside of the meat that's typically dry. It's a dry rub. Now, a lot of the times we have these things, these pre-made mixes, and Old Bay seasoning is one. I have Thai seasoning. I have Chinese five spice. These are pre-mixed and pre-measured seasoning mixes. To demystify it, like I said in the beginning, I'm going to start with my main ingredient is usually brown sugar. And I'll show you what happens to this. Because when we go to put this in the smoker, we'll smoke one that has a dry rub on it, and we'll smoke one that doesn't have a dry rub on it. I'm going to be real simple here. This is my brown sugar. What I'm going to do is I'm going to add to this Cajun seasoning, just a little bit. That adds a little bit of heat, but not a lot of salt. This is also a mixture, a dry mixture that I put on top of beef, and it has four parts to it. It has salt and pepper, garlic, and thyme. Now, to make the rub, as you see, this is pretty much all sugar. This is pretty much all sugar, because what's going to happen is I want this sugar to caramelize on the outside and give me a nice glaze. The salt and pepper is minimal. There's not a lot of meat on a rib, but what meat is there is really, really nice and tender. It's only tender because we've butchered it and we've smoked it for a long time. If you cook this on a grill really quickly, it's going to tighten up and be really tight and tough. You have to cook it low and slow. That's our big secret in doing barbecue. All right, for operational purposes here, I'm just going to take the rub, sprinkle it on one side, flip it, and do the same thing. Now, I'll rub this up, but as I butcher these other ones, my assistant partner here will take these and put these in the smoker. While I'm doing the rest of this butchering, taking the membrane off, Ali's going to talk about smoke. When you buy smoke, or smoke, when you smoke, what type of wood do you use?
I like the mesquite. I like the flavor, and that's what I like.
Okay.
I learned something today from you, though. I'll start putting it in the water, and so it'll smoke a little slower.
One of the things that we do before we start the smoking process is I take the chips and I soak them in water. It makes the chips last a lot longer. It also helps produce steam and lets the smoke last longer in the smoker, because when I'm burning wood, if it's dry wood, it burns hotter and faster than if I do it low and slow. So I actually want the chips soaked so they're gonna last longer. All right, I'm gonna finish this butchering, and then in the smoke piece, when we talk about the smoker, I buy chips right from the hardware store, the Lowe's, the Home Depot. Yeah. They sell the smokers, they also sell the chips. Now, the type of wood you use is integral to how your final product is going to come out. Mesquite is generally a wood that they use in Texas for smoking brisket and beef items. When they get up to the Carolinas, they use peach and sometimes apple and hickory. That's the center part of the state, what they use for smoking. You get up north here, we use maple, oak. I'm a big fan of, and I told this to Bob, I only use wood from trees that have been struck by lightning. All right? It's funny, but what I usually do is, with the way modern Doppler radar happens, you can tell a lightning strike within 30 feet. If there's a tree there and it's been struck, I have wood for a year. I'm kidding you, that's only a joke. But what happens is,
it's a bad joke.
Generally, if you're using the chips from, or with my big smoker, I use whole logs. I season the wood. I use black walnut too, is one of my favorites to use. The difference in the smoke and the chips makes a huge difference in the final product. Today we are using mesquite. It's going to make a huge difference when we're done. The smoker's the next big thing. I'm going to actually let Ollie take a walk around their smoker and let you see while I butcher another piece.
Simple to open up, don't get burned.
Now, inside, what he's gonna do is, down bottom, it's tough to see from here, there's a little cabinet where we put the chips inside. When the chips are inside, we put them in, and they're actually put next to direct flame, or not direct flame, but direct heat. When they're in the direct heat, they create a little bit of smoke that goes inside of this. The inside of this smoker never goes above 250 degrees. That's very, very slow. If you're gonna do this at home, you can actually smoke on your grill outside by putting chips on top of the burners in a big, thick Griswold or cast iron little pan. The same thing will happen. You can create a smoker with your grill at home. If you're gonna use a smoker like this in your house, number one, you're gonna have to have ventilation, you're gonna have to turn off your smoke alarm. This will set off the smoke alarm in a heartbeat. I always said, you're not really cooking unless the smoke alarm's going off. For our purposes today, we'll rub this. That one's ready. I'll take this third one. You can rub these up. Yeah, the top one's ready to go in. You can use the tongs.
You want to go on top?
That can go on top, and we can work from the top down. And while this is going on, while I finish this piece here, getting them in there is a little bit, because you're doing from the top, it's a little bit more of a challenge. Getting them in, getting to go in sideways. Oh, I know. You have to, that's it. Good. Just turn it to the side. We made a fast rub. We're actually going to make some more rub. Okay, let's rub these up. You have to do something. It gives me a chance to do a little bit more talking. You can buy a commercially prepared rub. The problem with commercially prepared rubs is a lot of them have a lot more salt in them. When you're smoking or roasting a whole piece of meat, like a brisket or a pork shoulder, you're gonna see the effect of the rub on the outside of the finished product. There's gonna be a ring of color around it. Usually it's called a smoke ring. And what happens is that change the chemicals in the rub chemically change the meat. Have you ever seen the difference between fresh pork and a prepared ham? The meat goes from white to pink. That's the exact same thing happens when the salt attacks the protein and chemically changes it. This is why in the dry rubs, a good dry rub, I use a little bit more sugar. Plus, when this sits for 5 minutes, it turns into a nice, beautiful, clear glaze on the outside. Once this heats high heat or smoke, it actually changes the glaze and changes the flavor of our finished product. That can go right in.
And like how I did that?
Just like you did the other one. It's a beautiful thing.
Does it matter if it's up or down?
It doesn't matter if it's up or down. At some point, you want to turn this on the inside because you also want to check halfway through the smoking process. For today's exercise, these are probably going to smoke for an hour and a half or 2 hours. We can rub this last one, put the last one in.
It's a little warm over here.
It's a little warm. If you can't stand the heat, go out to the gym. That would be a good thing to do. You don't see me in the gym because I don't sweat. I only sweat when I'm cooking near the kitchen. What we end up doing here is when we do this is actually protecting the meat and adding flavor. The sugar doesn't draw moisture out of the meat like salt does. So the sugar actually adds flavor, it adds texture, it chemically changes the meat, and it also adds, it's something else to hold up the amount of salt that I'm not going to use on this. Now, the rule with salt and pepper is, that's why it sits on the table. I can always add more salt, and I can always add more pepper. Salt, when it hits moisture, dissolves, and you're left with sodium, and the salt flavor actually dissipates across the liquid that it's attached to. Pepper, when it hits moisture, triples or quadruples in heat. So when you put pepper on in this stage and it hits moisture, it triples in the heat. This is why we like to keep it on the table and let people add it themselves. I can add salt, I can add hot, but I can't take them out once they're in there and attached to the moisture. Now, once he has that in there, now typically when you're at the board and you have any rub left that has raw meat juice on it, we don't use it. But what we do like to do is take some of this, and this is what we do when it comes out. We actually reserve this, and I'll use this on the outside just before I go to grill it. So this same rub, because when you mix spices together, spices are very expensive. It's like the most expensive part of the food group. We don't like to waste them, so what we like to do is have them later to use for on the outside. Some people actually, instead of using sauce, when our ribs come out, they are so moist, they don't need sauce. But what I usually like to do is add some of the dry rub right on the outside as a flavoring ingredient. Some of the barbecue stores down south, what they usually like to do is have a shaker of rub on the table, and you actually shake the rub as one of your dressings for the sauce.
What am I doing?
Gotta lift it. Well, let me pull this aside. Now do it.
Okay.
There's a latch in there. Now, normally, I gotta be honest, I always have to have a lock on my smoker because where I live, if I leave my smoker unlocked, somebody comes in the middle of the night and usually checks on it. Do you have that problem?
Never.
No, you have an armed guard next to it? I'm gonna tell you something, the longer it's there, it's just kind of like bait, and it brings all the people who haven't eaten in a while up to the smoker, and they always like to find out what's cooking and what's for eating. Okay, now, one of the things I wanna do, I'm gonna take the rest of my rub, and we're gonna make a sauce. Now, normally sauce is like the huge thing, and a lot of these barbecue people are very, very secretive about their sauce. I give it right up. If I'm gonna make a sauce for a competition, and doing huge competitions is a big deal, I'll brew it myself. I'll add things like anchovies, coffee, little things to give it a little touch at the end, but it's only when I brew it. The difference between Ollie and myself is when I'm gonna do some barbecue, I'm doing it for 1,000 people at a time. He's gonna do it for the family and whoever's coming, especially the outlaws. They come all the time when you smoke, don't they?
They try,
yeah, keep them away.
That's right.
When I'm doing that, and I'm doing it for large people, I buy prepared sauce and I fix it up. I usually like a thinner sauce, and it comes already with a gum that kind of thickens it up. Gum is one of the things that they use to emulsify sauce and keep it from separating. I'll take a regular bottled sauce and I'll cut it with apple juice and orange juice or nut or pineapple juice, unsweetened pineapple juice.
So if I go to the store, I ask for gum?
No, you're never going to get it. If you ask for gum, they're going to put you right next to the
heard of that one.
Yeah. Yet. Well, it's one of those technical things that I get to do. I'm pretty sure you have some technical things about the gym that you don't tell me, right? All right, we'll leave it like that. I took a regular prepared sauce, and now we're going to taste. This is like the best part of what we do. I took a regular prepared sauce. I want you to try this with that, and don't spit it out. It's just not right. I take a prepared sauce, and this is, I don't like to name names unless we're getting an endorsement here at the college. What I usually like to have is, this is a bottle sauce. It's actually kind of sporty. It has a little hot at the end, sweet in the middle. I took unsweetened pineapple juice to a bottled sauce. Now, there's a whole bunch of stories behind the sauces. But when I get to this point, I add some of my rub, and the rub that I use actually has a little bit of pepper in it. So right now, it should be kind of hot in your mouth.
It is hot.
But it's sweet when you start. Now, that's a standard red tomato-y barbecue sauce. It's kind of sweet, kind of hot. We're going to make one that's real, real simple, and not a lot of people have. There's a guy called Maurice, and he's down in South Carolina, and he makes a Carolina mustard sauce. This is the coolest thing on the planet. I have three ingredients that we're going to use. Vinegar, brown sugar, and yellow salad mustard. I'm going to let you do the honors.
Sure, it'll taste wonderful.
Oh, it'll taste dynamite.
Okay.
All right. Now, let's take four scoops of that, four big heaping helpings. Usually this is equal amounts of brown sugar, yellow salad mustard, prepared regular old-fashioned salad mustard, and apple cider vinegar. We're going to blend this down till it reaches a specific consistency. One more will do it. That's good. All right, now, I'll add the brown sugar. You're going to be in charge of mixing. Now, equal amount says I can always add more of anything else. Okay, let's leave this on the side. Leave this in here in case we have to adjust. All right, now whip that together. And then what we're going to add, as the vinegar, I'm going to add vinegar to here slowly. Like I said, I can always add more. This is acid, sugar, and mustard. It's a really heinous combination when you think about it, but when it comes together,
it doesn't sound too good
until you taste it, and then it's out of this world. Now what happens is this is going to turn a little bit more brown. All right. You have to whip this like you whip an athlete, you know? When we're smacking a horse, like making a horse race, we want to get it around low so it's going like crazy. All right, let's set it down. Let's put two more scoops of mustard in there. Mustard it up a little bit. Now, this takes, I can make this less brown by using light brown sugar. And when this comes out, we're actually going to use this on some of the ribs when we're finished. Okay? I'm just taking over the whipping thing because just like doing laps, I can do laps, but probably not as good as you. That's a good thing. Now I'm gonna taste this, and if I like start to choke or heave, that's another story. Oh, damn, I got it all over me. That's good. Try that, you'll see the flavor profile.
Same way.
Same, just don't get it. Well, see, you have an apron. I got it on my.
That's good.
He surprised you, didn't it?
That's good.
It has a little sport to it. We're gonna let this rest. Because what I'm going to do now is I'm going to bring out the ribs that we've already done and we have together on the that have already been smoked but not put into the oven. Because what we're going to do is we're going to use that sauce, the sauce that we just made, the sauce that came from the prepared bottle, and we're going to sauce two sets of ribs and put them in the oven. Could you hand me that barrel of ribs? We've already prepared these, and I actually want to show everybody. This is what they look like coming out of the smoker. They've already pulled, the meat has already shrunk enough to come off the bone a little bit, but these are actually really kind of tough. They don't fall apart. This top is how the rub glazes across the top when it hits some heat. And this little piece, I'm going to cut into this to show you the cross section, what it looks like. For right now, I'm going to use foil. Foil's an integral part of what we're going to do. First thing I'm going to do before I sauce this, I'm going to take some of my red sauce, put it on the bottom of the pan or the bottom of the foil. I'm going to take my rib, I'm going to put it in here, I'm going to do the same thing. This is red sauce on the top and on the bottom. To seal this up, I'm going to seal it like a package. I want to put the ends in because when I go to unwrap this, I want to unwrap this the same way that I wrapped it up. I want to unroll it and bring it over the top. This is going to steam the meat. I'm going to stick this right back in my pan. I'm going to do the same thing, and now I'm going to do some with the mustard sauce. You pull the foil out enough to cover the ribs around both sides. Since Ollie made this dressing, I'm going to let him dress this. You make the sauce, cover the bottom, put some in the bottom.
So we can out of there. Sauce.
Yeah, just some of the sauce. Take the spoon, nice little layer on the bottom.
A little more?
Oh yeah, a little more. Because this is going to coat the outside. All right, spread it out. Let's put that rib right on top and then do the same thing. We'll cover the top. And you can put it in there. And then do the beautiful, you know, the beautiful science associated with video. I already have one getting ready to come out of the oven that we're going to cut and taste right away.
A little bit more?
Yeah, I do a little bit more. Okay. You like a lot of sauce or a little sauce?
Little.
A little sauce?
Not
I
a
can,
lot.
Well, it's just like everything else. I can always add more sauce. Okay? This just makes it easier. Now what you'll do is, I'm gonna slice that up. Let me put this in the oven.
Okay.
And I'm gonna pull my other one out of the oven.
People are gonna think I can really cook this, Doc.
We'll undo that in a second. I'll come behind you here. Now, before we go to do this, one of the important things that I want to look at is the cross section, or how this looks when it's not done, halfway done. This is what the inside of the rib's going to look like. A lot of meat, but see, that's actually still kind of pink on the inside. This is fully cooked right out of the smoker. So this didn't spend any time. It just spent a little time on the grill, but not heavy heat. So as you can see, the meat's fully cooked, but it's actually not tender. The thing that makes it tender is steaming this meat off the bone. So for the finish of this, what I have is I have this one that's, ouch, this is hot. This has been in the oven, steamed with sauce, ready to go. And I doubled this up, so it's more of a surprise. You can see the steam coming off. This has sauce, and you see, we didn't put a lot of sauce on this. We didn't put a lot of sauce on this, but this is ready to come out, sliced, to be sliced and sauced. So that comes apart. I don't want any of this. Okay. Now this is actually ready to have sauce and be cut. Now I use a French knife. Now the way this goes, I'm gonna slice into this. Now these are very tender. I can actually pick these up. When I pick this up, it can actually pull these apart. See how it's falling off the bone? That's the desired effect. Now these are done. You can tell frozen meat. Now a lot of times, unless you're getting absolutely fresh pork, you're getting fresh pork or something directly from the butcher, to tell the difference is the color of the bone. See how this gets pasty on the side? These were frozen ribs. They're perfectly fine because they come up the nice at the, you know, in the very end, they come up very nice. If you're going to do something for a competition, they have to be fresh and never frozen. Now these look absolutely dynamite. There's one way to try. What do you think? We're going to try some.
I think
tasting would be a good thing. I'm going to get sloppy here. Put some sauce right over here. We have our towels to wipe our faces with, which is good. We're going to try some with the mustard sauce. Not a lot, you know, because it's not to some people's taste. All right, here's the important part. It's kind of what we're after.
You got to get prepared.
I think you're getting prepared?
Yeah.
Get the gullet ready? I'm ready. Dig in. You first. Guests first. Let's pick it up. It's like it's caveman style. We're going to do this with our fingers.
You know what? I'm real strange because I normally eat with a knife and fork.
You do? Knife and fork on ribs?
And ribs, yeah.
I think we're going to have to get a knife and fork. Don't mind me. I'm digging right in. What I really want to do is, can you just pick up a little piece and eat it? If we tear one off?
If you twist my arm, I guess.
I'll twist your arm.
I'll check it out. Oh, that's great.
That's unbelievable, isn't it?
That's great.
It's real simple. What we really like about this is the ribs work kind of all by themselves. Our production assistant is nice enough to bring us a knife and a fork.
It's more civil this way.
What? Your in-laws have had an influence on you, I think. That's funny. What do you think?
Excellent.
It's amazing.
Excellent.
What's really simple about this process is there's four steps. You can do the four steps in a lot of different ways. You can actually do this, do the ribs on a two-day process. You can actually blanch them, which is what we do when we pull them out of the smoker. They're not fully cooked, but they're seasoned. We can finish them on the grill. The important step in making them come out tender like this, just like this, so they're nice and tender and they fall apart, is the last 20 minutes of cooking, you're gonna wrap it with the sauce in aluminum foil. That helps get the meat from this section, where it's tough and stuck to the bone, to falling off the bone. Once the meat starts at 212 degrees, so this can actually be in a medium to low oven, water steams, it turns to steam, and that's enough to release the protein from the bone. As long as that last part of the job where they're coming off of the bone, when it's in foil, it will steam itself off the bone. And that's one of the big secrets to making a nice tender rib when we're done at the end. What do you think?
I think that I'll start eating ribs for breakfast now.
Breakfast of champions is kind of what we do. Thanks for spending time with me.
Oh, it was a
pleasure. I had a ball. It was absolutely fantastic.
Anytime you want to cook and offer me an opportunity to stand,
I'll be over there. Just don't ask me to come over to the gym.
Okay.
Okay? Thanks. Thanks for spending time with us here at Community College of Philadelphia.